your hair.
Somebody else did.
But yeah.
They had more talent than I would. Yeah, she told me I went too short, and I think I went a little too short because I'm
flyaway. Oh, that's nice. Okay, I can fix it.
It seems like they would have skipped the hymn number 666 in the hymnal. But they didn't, so we're singing it. Would you stand as we begin our service and join in the hymn?
Thank you.
continue in the service booklet on page 3. Blessed be the God of our salvation. Remember, Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions, but think on me in your goodness, O Lord, according to your steadfast love. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
O keep my soul and deliver me. Let me not be put to shame, for I have put my trust in you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Our first reading this morning is a reading from the book of Exodus. God spoke all these words to Moses on Mount Sinai. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other God before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents, to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath days and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughters, your male or female slaves, your livestock, or the alien residents in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkeys, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 19. You have it in as an insert in your program. And we'll read this responsibly by verse. The heavens declare the Lord of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork.
One day tells its tales to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no word or language, and their voices are not heard.
Their sounds have gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world.
In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the utmost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat.
The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey, and honey in the comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Our second reading is a reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where's the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Stand and sing our gospel hymn number 151.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 40 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Ten Commandments. Strike fear in my heart. We often relate to the Ten Commandments as a club, essentially. Like, if you don't do this, bad things are going to happen to you, right? I hope I'm not the only one who has that association. But really, the Ten Commandments are an invitation to relationship. They're not a threat. They're an invitation. "Come and live with me," God says. "I'll give you some helpful guidelines that will keep you close, that will keep you from temptation, that will shore up the boundaries of our relationship, and be in relationship with each other. I'll give you some more rules, some more guidelines." The word rule, by the way, means measure, right? How do we measure up? How do we measure ourselves over against the expectations, the invitations that we have been invited into? So the Ten Commandments are broken up into two sections. One of the first section deals with how we relate to God, and the second part deals with how we relate to our neighbors. And really, it's all about relationship. It's all about being in communion with God and each other. So when I think of it that way, it kind of takes the fear or the threat out of the equation and makes me more hopeful about living into this invitation to relationship. Now, it's certainly true that the Ten Commandments can be used as a club and as a threat, and have been throughout the course of human experience, but they don't have to be that. We don't have to experience them that way. When Jesus goes into the temple in John's gospel, it's at the very beginning of his ministry. In the other gospels, it's at the end. It happens just before the crucifixion. But in John's gospel, it happens on the first Passover, which is 2 years before the crucifixion. Jesus is stirring things up. He's causing a commotion. He's interrupting the normal operating procedures of the temple. One commentator that I read compared the temple to an abattoir. You know what an abattoir is? A slaughterhouse. There would have been hundreds, if not thousands, of animals being prepared for ritual sacrifice. This was all part and parcel to the way that Jews understood their obligations in terms of their relationship with God. The way to repair a breach was through sacrifice. And depending on how wealthy you were, would determine what kind of sacrifice you would be required to make. So oxen, if you're loaded, or maybe a turtle dove, if you're poor, or maybe even just some grain. So Jesus goes into the temple, and I think it's hard for us to kind of imagine, because we probably think of like Jesus coming in here and saying, "What do you think you're doing? Stop that. That's not what God wants." But Jesus, the temple was huge. I mean, it was vast. And the operation of the temple was immense. There were lots of things going on, especially right now at Passover, one of the three major festivals when people came from all over the world to the temple to participate in the rituals. So they were coming from all over the world, so they were bringing money from all over the world, so they needed to exchange their money for the temple money to be able to pay the tax. They had to purchase animals that were raised in and around Jerusalem for sacrifice. It was a huge economy. And it was all part of the law of Moses. They were doing exactly what was required of them according to the law of Moses. Jesus comes in and, you know, I question how effective his demonstration was. You know, I think of the vast expanse of the temple and how much would have been going on and how many people would have been there. I think he probably wasn't able to turn over all the money tables and drive out all the animals from the temple. That would have required a legion of soldiers, probably. But he certainly did something in terms of upsetting the way that things were going on. And probably his disciples made it sound better than it actually was after a while, you know what I mean? That was our guy. He really turned things over in the temple. Nevertheless, Jesus is is trying to interrupt this system of ritual sacrifice. Why? Why is he doing this? At the beginning of John's gospel, of his ministry. The same reason that God gave the Ten Commandments. For the sake of relationship. Jesus was trying to say, in a symbolic way, that our relationship with God is not transactional. I'll do this, and you do this. If I give you two turtle doves and a sheaf of wheat, then you give me a good harvest this year. That's not how God works. Our relationship with God is not transactional, it's relational. God wants to be in relationship with us. So if you're going to make a sacrifice in the temple, do it for the sake of relationship, not as a transaction where you're going to get something in return from God for what you've offered. I think this was Jesus' main point, trying to help people understand that God desires to be in relationship with us. And in fact, this is kind of the overture in John's gospel of Jesus' whole ministry. I think that's why it's there at the beginning. Because what Jesus does from there on is show them what it means to be in relationship with God. I am in him, he is in me. I abide, you should abide. Let's come together, let's be one in God. Let's be in relationship. So, I think this is really hard for us to understand because we live in a world that is fundamentally transactional, right? I mean, I once had a guy say, I'd made some change in the church building. And he said, when are you going to put that back the way it was before? I pay your salary. I went and checked, and he didn't pay my salary. He didn't come anywhere close to paying my salary. But that's how we think. That's how we interact in the world. It's transactional. I'll give you this, you give me that, and everything will be copacetic. So it takes a lot to shift us out of that mode of existence when we think about our relationship with God. God does not want to be in a transactional relationship with you or with me. God wants our relationship to be based in mutual love. And Jesus comes to demonstrate how that works and what that looks like. And so as we follow him in these next few weeks to the cross, let us have in mind that desire of God to be in relationship, to be one with us. God's call, God's invitation to love and unity. Amen.
Thank you.
stand and join in the affirmation of faith on page 5 of the service booklet. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though
he was divine, Christ Jesus did not regard equality with God, but claiming to be rest, but emptying himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in human likeness, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him, and given him the name, which is the Lord of their name.
Gathering all that commands our prayers, let us intercede with our gracious God, saying, have mercy, O Lord. For the church that God's commandments may ever close to us, wonderful to ponder and life-giving to keep, we pray. For the church of those who will be baptized at Easter, may be drawn to the folly and weakness of God in Christ, crucified, we pray.
Have mercy, Lord.
For our divided and restless world, that those who hold power over others may be troubled and transformed by the demands of justice, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For children, that infants and young people of every nation may have food and learning, and that they may love their world, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For this gathered community, that the solemn brightness of lunch may open our eyes to these times, their folly and their worth, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For the dead, especially those who held to and handed on God's commandment until our day, that they may be at peace, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
Jealous and merciful God, remember us and all those whom we hold in our hearts. In these 40 days, teach us to do the work of our baptism, and so daily to raise to you the needs of the world. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Peace, lady.
Ooh, pretty.
In the foyer on the table. You still have time to jump in the middle here, so please feel free to take one. Are there any announcements?
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing to give you thanks, O holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we say, Holy,
holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, gracious God,
creator of the universe and giver of life.
You formed us in your own image
and called us to dwell in your infinite love.
You gave the world into our care
that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace.
But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves.
We would not see your goodness in the world around us, so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love.
Yet you never ceased to care for us
and prepared the way of salvation for all people.
Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you.
You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation.
Then in the fullness of time,
you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus, born into the human family and dwelling among us. He revealed your glory, giving himself freely to the death on the cross. He triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life.
On the night before he died for us,
our Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me.
As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine.
And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me.
Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering his death and resurrection,
we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ.
Grant that we who share these gifts
may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world.
Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons,
that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever.
Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ,
in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise, forever and ever.
Amen. As our Savior taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us peace.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God,
we thank you for bringing us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of Christ, and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you, as faithful witnesses of Christ our Savior, to him and to you and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross, and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Canon is 685.
Unless we're going to go down and add that. And how much we go to you then? Unless you go see us again.
To love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.